I don't really have a sermon that I study because I've preached so many resurrection sermons. I figure by now, if I can't tell you a story about Jesus rising from the dead, then I don't need to be a pastor anymore. And so with all my years of doing this, I've tried to strike the hearts of the audience with a profound, different, mystical secret that maybe you didn't know about Resurrection Sunday. Maybe you didn't know how someone is crucified. Maybe you didn't know that Jesus, the sparks was not drilled through his hand, but they were driven through his wrist. Maybe you didn't know about how the cats of nine tails ripped his flesh off. And I spent all these different Easter Sundays coming up with some kind of facts, even statistical facts about how people have walked away from the church, how the millennials don't even believe in God. And all these statistical facts to find something that would resonate with you, something that you would take home. But I realized in all that I was doing, I forgot the most important thing. It wasn't about the stats and the facts and the statistics and the horror and the pain and suffering. It wasn't about that. It was about one thing. Prepare yourself for it. I love as I get older, I learn something every day. It was about the infinite love of the resurrection. It was about the love that went into the grave and snatched our Savior up. It was about the promise that God gave. It was about that they whooped him and beat him and tore him to pieces and despised him and betrayed him. But that did not deter God's love. It was about the promise. It was about the fulfillment. And it was about the commitment that God had. So this resurrection is only about one thing, God told me. It's about the power of the love of God. Just let that sit for a minute. If you take out love out of this equation, what would you have? Just try to think about that for a minute. We had all the elements of hate. And if you take out love out of Resurrection Sunday, out of the third day, what other reason did God have to raise Jesus? He could have simply just said, hey, I'm going to abort this mission. In my heart, I thought I could go through it. In my heart, I thought I could watch my son be bruised and beaten and rejected. He is the Son of God. He is me manifest in flesh. We humans don't deserve this kind of grace. Look how we treated him. God could have just said, you know what, Jesus, in the Garden of Gethsemane, Elijah, go get him. God could have said, it's day one. He's still there. Michael, go get him. He could have said to hell with all these humans, I curse them, for they are constant thorns in my side. They don't love each other. They betray each other. They backbite each other. They're just like the Israelites. What reason? I imagine he was talking to the Holy Spirit. I imagine he was talking to Michael again. What reason do I have to continue this promise? I could easily change my mind. I am God. I have all the ability, all the authority, and all the power to do what I want to do. And yet we have Easter egg hunts, and Bunny Rabbit is more popular than Jesus. One thing that grieved my heart today, as I was driving, I saw all kinds of people, and they were on their bikes, they were jogging, they were already at the park playing little plastic eggs. They were buying their beer, their carne asada, they had all the discada, they had all the tortillas, they were just ready to go, man. Baskets was flying out of the shelf at Walmart, all these other marts. It was unbelievable. Nobody once said anything about Jesus. It was about the day that we get to go party. Why are you partying? Do you even know why? Because the Bunny Rabbit said we can party. He's going to hop on around. I saw a guy with a big carrot driving on his truck. And I just said, God, we got to tell the story. So here's the thing. This story starts on a Friday. And so I'm going to tell you the story. And then we're going to take communion also. I want you to put yourself in the story. I want you to put yourself at the table of Jesus. This story begins with jealousy, envy, and pride. What are you talking about, Pastor? This story begins with jealousy, envy, and pride, and a demonic possession.
Huh?
Yeah, Christians can be possessed also. You know how we do that? We give ourselves to God for our salvation, but we hold on to those things that give us our strength. We keep our anger, that's a spirit. We keep our hate, that's a spirit. We keep our pride, that's a spirit. We keep our jealousy, that's a spirit. But we say, God, come into our life and forgive me of all my sins, but I'm not gonna give you that stuff. I just want repentance for that. We keep our addictions, oh yeah. So many Christians have addictions. That's why today I'm giving an altar call for all addictions. But we are saved by grace, not by perfection. We are the unfinished work of Christ. But we have to strive, we have to want, we have to desire to follow everything that Jesus says. Because above all other laws and commandments, above all prophecies, above all Old Testament, above the Ten Commandments, there is nothing that trumps red letter. Nothing. Nothing. Nobody has the right to say that anybody is far more wiser, far more powerful than God speaking to us. Do you get that? God speaking to us. Not through a prophet, through him. So this word started in chapter 22 of Luke. Turn to your Bible. Chapter 22, verse 1. It started on a Friday night. And it says here that the beginning of it is Judas agrees to betray Jesus. And I want to just point out one point because I'm going to just keep going real fast until I get to the resurrection. It says that on Friday, the festival of the unleavened bread, which is also called the Passover, was approaching. And the leading priests and teachers of religious law were plotting on how to kill Jesus. But they were afraid of the people's reaction. But they was afraid of the people's reaction. Now check out this next verse. If you don't think that Christians can be possessed. Then Satan entered into Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12 disciples. And he went to the leading priests and captains of the temple guard to discuss the best way to betray Jesus to them. And they were delighted and they promised to give him money. So he agreed and began looking. The devil is as a roaring lion, searching, looking for who he may devour. And he began to looking and searching for an opportunity to betray Jesus so they could arrest him. I just read that this week and I was like, what? Satan entered into not a demon. Satan is not omnipresent. He's only one. He can only be one place at one time. But Satan himself, that's how much he wanted to deter God's plan. And he possessed Judas. But Judas was one of the 12 disciples, was he not? For 3.5 years, he saw marvelous miracles. So why did Judas betray him? What was in Judas's heart? Well, if we read about Judas, we understand that there was a lot of times that he had friction with Jesus. He was jealous how Jesus treated this person. He was jealous how come we spend money over there. Judas was always envious, always prideful about something. He never just went along with the Son of God. Why couldn't he just follow the Son of God like the other 11? Why couldn't he just trust God? But oh no, he had to go and do his own thing, his own way. He was stubborn. And so God sifted his heart and said, I'm going to let the devil get you. Because deep down inside, you're full with all the things that I require. You got to have. There was no love in Judas' heart. If you go and read about Judas, he was always angry. He was always wanting to go against Jesus. Judas lacked love. Because love holdeth all. Do it for all, trust it for all. Love doesn't keep no record of wrongdoings and counting them. I remember this, I remember that. Love forgives, love heals, love restores. And so that was the problem. And so we go on to this, we go to the Last Supper. Jesus tells his disciples that we need to go and have a feast of the unleavened bread has arrived, and the Passover lamb is sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John ahead to go and prepare a Passover meal so we can eat together. Because see, Jesus knew this would be his Last Supper with his boys. He knew that he was about to go through a horrible, agonizing death. So he just wanted one last meal, but in this meal, he revealed a lot. And so to go on, they went ahead and got a room, and he went ahead and he stood up in verse 17, and he took the cup and he gave thanks to it. And he said, take this and share it amongst yourself. And he says, for I will not drink wine again until the kingdom of God has come. So he took the bread and he gave thanks to it. And he said, this is my body, which is given for you. He said, do this in remembrance of me. So we eat the bread. And then he went on and he took another cup of wine and he said, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people. Think about that for a minute. As I partake of this wine, which represents his blood, I am saying, I agree with the new covenant with God. So I can't hold on to my old ways, my old things, because this is a new thing that God is requiring us to walk in. This love thing is so hard because we want to hold on to all our feelings. But this love thing is not about a feeling. So Jesus wanted us to know this one thing, that this cup is a new covenant between God and his people, an agreement to confirm with my blood, which is poured out for the sacrifice of you. So Jesus then got a room. Judas has been possessed. And now he's having the Last Supper with his boys. And now he's about to start revealing some serious stuff. As they were taking the Last Supper, they were eating, and I imagine they were having fun and celebrating, talking, you know. They probably had two or three glasses of wine, because if you read this, it said Jesus took another cup of wine. So I imagine if Jesus already had two, they might have three or four. So imagine how they was all feeling. They was feeling good. They had a reason to, because something horrible was about to happen. As they took the cup, Jesus said this, here at this table, sitting among us, is a friend, is a man who will betray me. But it has been determined that the Son of Man must die. And so when Jesus saw that, they began to ask who would ever do such a thing. And then they began to argue among themselves about who would be the greatest. What? How do you go from being concerned about who betrayed Jesus to, well, who's going to be the greatest? It's all flesh. And so they begin to argue about that. And Jesus just began to tell them that, look, it's more important that the one who sits at the table is the one who serves. The one who sits at the table, of course, who's more important? But not here, not in my kingdom, not in God's structure. He says, I'm among you as the one who will serve. So what he was telling them is that don't be worried about who's going to be big and bad. Don't be worried about who's going to have the best of this. Worry about this. In God's kingdom, is he that is the least shall be the first. In God's kingdom, he says, to humble yourself and I will exalt you. In God's kingdom, it's not a duplication of the things of the world, because he says, in the custom of the world, the man that sits at the head of the table is the most important person. He says, but in God's kingdom, I sit at the head of the table, but I'm the least important person. And so what Jesus was telling us is to prefer one another, no matter what. And as he exposed who would betray him, it seemed like everybody just went crazy. But then everybody started grabbing for what they wanted from Jesus, not what Jesus wanted. And so it goes on that as he dealt with Judas, now here comes Peter. Who's Peter? Peter is the most beloved disciple, the one that Jesus says, Peter, upon this rock, upon you, Peter, I will build my church. Peter was the speaker for the Jews. Peter was the one that was to bring salvation to the Jews, and Paul was the one that would bring salvation to the Gentile. And they were important. And Peter was strong. Peter had anointing. Peter had a gift. Peter was one of those guys that would go ride and die for Jesus, and he was boisterous, he was loud, he had authority, and he was the leader of the pack. Jesus tells him, Simon, Satan has sifted your heart like wheat, but I have pleaded in prayer for you. Wow. Jesus knowing, he says, I have pleaded in prayer for you, Simon, that your faith shall not fail, so that when you have repented and turned to me again, strengthen your brothers. And Simon was like, what are you talking about, Jesus? He says, Lord, I'm ready to go to prison. I'm ready to die with you. But Jesus says, I tell you, before the rooster crows in the morning, you will deny me three times. This all happened in the same night. And then we go on that Jesus left their upper room. He said, okay, that's enough. I need to go pray because I'm about to get arrested. And so he takes his time and he rolls out of the upper room and they follow him and he goes down to the Mount of Olives, which is known as the Garden of Gethsemane. And so what happened is he went there to pray. And he told us, he said, to pray that you will not give in to temptation. And it says that he walked about a stone's throw away and he began to pray. And I want to let you know this. This is something that God spoke to me. This was the Son of God, tired like us. The Son of God to get weak like us. You got to understand, Jesus was in flesh. So he got tired. Imagine 3.5 years with these crybaby disciples. They fought more than the board of any church, but yet they love God and they learned to come together. So as I get that picture, I can imagine, you know, they were fighting all the time. Look, Jesus said, I'm about to die. Here's what I said. They started arguing. Who's going to be the greatest? So he goes and he prays. He says, Father, I'm tired. He says, but if it was willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. But yet I want your will to be done. And look what God does. No matter where you're at in your walk, no matter where you are in your walk, no matter how tired you get, God will always hear your prayer. God will come to you and he will strengthen. If you're struggling with addiction, God will come and deliver you. If you're struggling with things that you need to get rid of, God will get to you. If you're struggling with your faith, God will come. But you have to be honest with God. You have to cry out to God. You got to let God know that I need you. And so what Jesus did, he let God know that. And it says here, and then an angel from heaven appeared and strengthened him, and he prayed more fervently. He received the strength of God. He was able to run and not go weary. He was able to mount up with wings of eagles. He said that times of refreshing comes from God, and he began to receive that so he can carry on his race because he was tired. And he says, and he prayed more fervently, and he was in such agony of spirit that his sweat fell to the ground as great drops of blood. Why was Jesus in such agony in his spirit? Why do you think he was grieved? Peter denied him. Judas betrayed him. 3.5 years of doing this, knowing that he was going to have to suffer, knowing that he was going to have to die. Who could do this race? Could you finish this race? Could you bear this race? It didn't say that his flesh, it said that his spirit. He was in such agony of his spirit. Sometimes, as a pastor, as a clergy, as a husband or a wife, as a Christian, we just get tired. We're not so much physically tired, but we're spiritually tired because we got to fight all day long. We're fighting ourselves, we're fighting our family, we're fighting our attacks that come daily from our finances, to our family, to our friends, to our co-workers. It's just a constant spiritual battle. Don't get weak. Understand this, that God will give you strength, that nothing else can. But you have to be honest about your condition. You have to say, God, I'm struggling. And then, right after that, Jesus was betrayed and arrested. And Judas led the way and betrayed him with a kiss. And then right after that, Peter, like clockwork, denies Jesus three times. And then right after that, Jesus is brought to trial before Pilate. And Pilate says, I have nothing against this man. Take him to Herod. And so Jesus goes to Herod, and Herod wants him to deny who he is. And he turned him over to the crowd, and the crowd said to crucify him. And so then Jesus is crucified. He is led like a lamb to the slaughter, like all the prophecies and all the things that would be told about him. He's led to die as a criminal death and not having no sin in his life. And so they begin to go through the crucifixion, and they go through the stages. And then Jesus finally gives up his last breath, and he says, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. And of course, he says it is finished. And then our Savior, his last breath, is gone. And that was the order of fighting. And so for 3 days, Friday evening around 3 o'clock, Saturday, Sunday, it says here in verse 24, but very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb to take spices that they had prepared, because it was tradition that she didn't want the body to continue to smell. So you would go in each day to keep put spices until the decay of all the flesh and the stench was gone. And that was just a way of honoring the dead. And so they were faithful, but it wasn't just Mary, it was Mary and several other women. And they went there. And it says here that on Sunday, they went to the tomb taking spices, and they found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. And so they went in, and they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And as they stood there puzzled, two men suddenly appeared with them and clothed in dazzling robes. I can imagine it probably was Michael and Gabriel. And so the women, they bowed down, and they were terrified, and their faces hit the ground, because see, no flesh can glorify the presence of God. And so it doesn't matter if you're in the presence of a demonic entity or a heavenly entity, because you are in flesh, it will bring fear and trembling. Have you ever felt the presence of something evil around you and you get all these goosebumps? Well, have you ever felt the anointing of God and you feel the same goosebumps? But what's the difference? God doesn't bring fear to you. The enemy brings fear to you. And so you're able by spirit to discern good and evil. And so I imagine when these two angels in their glory stood before them, of course they were terrified. And it says that they bowed down their faces. And then the men asked, why are you looking among the dead for someone who's alive? And so what I want to tell you today is, whatever you think about Jesus in your heart, whatever you think about Jesus in your mind, whatever part of the story you choose to believe, whatever it is that keeps you connected in your faith, I want you to know one thing. Jesus is not dead no more. And I want you to understand that you can only take up this cup that we just did if you accept the new covenant understanding that he is alive. And the angel said, he isn't here. He is risen from the dead. He is risen from the dead. Remember what he told you back in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of sinful men and be crucified. And then he would rise on the third day. Then they remembered what he said. So they rushed back from the tomb to tell the 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. It was Mary of Magdalene, and it was several other women who told the apostle what had happened. This resurrection was about God's power. It was about God's life-giving grace. It was about God's promise. And it was about his love. And as the story ends, Jesus goes on to do several things. Jesus actually stayed on earth for 40 days. How many knew that? We read the scriptures and we think, he came, he saw, and he went. No. Jesus kept it on earth for 40 days. He wanted you to know that I'm alive. He said, Thomas, touch my hands so you believe it. He said, blessed are those, Stephen, that has not seen me but yet believe me. He went and caught the boys fishing again. He said, hey, boys! Squat down his gangster squat. And he was stroking the fire. And he said, come here. I got some fish for y'all to eat. He took the two men walking on the road to Emmaus. Hey, what are you doing? Who are you? And Jesus is like, what's wrong? Why are you guys so sad? He goes, oh man, they killed the Son of God. They killed our Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus is like, wow. And then Jesus began on, he said, well, didn't Jesus tell you that all this was going to happen? And Jesus began to quote all the scriptures in the Old Testament and all the laws and the 300 prophecies about Jesus in the Old Testament. And these two men, they were apostles, and they were some of the 12, and they were so delighted, and Jesus just embraced them. And so they said, Jesus, stay with us. And so Jesus went back with them. And then all of a sudden, when he revealed who it was, he disappeared. And then Jesus went to every disciple. He went to the 12, and he caught them in the room. And he says, when I was with you before, I told you about everything written about me. And the law of Moses and the prophets and then the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened up their minds. He opened up their minds. He opened up their minds. You see, when God comes into your life, he opens up your mind. He makes you believe that you can do all things. He opens up your mind to give you faith to receive every great gift that he has. This faith walk is so hard, people. It's just like love. No matter how many times you give up, no matter how many times you get beat down, you gotta keep going. No matter times you lose your faith and you turn from God and you get involved in all kinds of things, you gotta get it back. There is only one truth. There is only one God. There is only one way. And nobody comes to the Father without going to the Son. And you either believe that or you don't. There is no other way to get this gift. Unfortunately, it requires a faith that we as humans are weak in. It requires a love that we as humans, we don't understand. There's only one way to receive this gift. That's the power of the resurrection. That's the love of the resurrection. That's the promise. Stand up. I didn't want to do anything but just tell you the story. You see, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were the greatest preachers in all the New Testament. And even though each of them have a slight difference, Luke is more detailed, Mark is more vague, John is more prophetic, and Matthew is probably records one of the most accurate situations. But they all have the same meaning. They all tell the wonderful story of what today is. Jesus says one last thing to his disciples before he goes. He tells us in Matthew 28:19, he says, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. He said, therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And he says, teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And he says, be sure of this, that I am with you always, even to the end of time. Resurrection. We wasn't there, was we? A lot of us in this room is like Thomas. Thomas was one of the disciples, but yet he didn't believe the reports that Jesus had risen from the dead. He lacked faith. Some of you in here are struggling with your faith, and you lack faith to believe that God can heal you. You lack faith to believe that God can deliver you. Well, I'm here to tell you, because of this great story, because of what has happened, God is here to relieve you. God is here to deliver you. God is here to heal you. He is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. He has not changed his promise, but what has changed is the way we see him. What has changed is the way we trust him. What has changed is the way we believe, because we have allowed all the other influence to come in and take away that pure divine connection and relationship with God. It's the world we live in. We can't help it. You know the difference between Generation X and the Millennium? Social media, technology. That's it. You know, in our days, you had to wait till you got to school to get some gossip. You had to hear about it 3 weeks later at a party. What? Oh, yeah, they was talking about you. But now on social media, you can hear it instantly. And then they can tell two friends, and they tell two friends, it's like that shampoo commercial. And so on, and so on, and so on, and so on, and it just begins, and next thing you know, you have been destroyed. Videos. That's what makes it so hard. Because every time we want to do something for God, somebody has something to say about it. You're doing it wrong, you didn't do it right, you should do it this way. Listen. you gotta work out your own salvation with God. The resurrected Savior is here for you. I want anybody that wants prayer for addiction to come up here. I want to pray with you today. I want anybody that wants healing to come up here. I want to pray for you today. I believe that God is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. I believe that this is the reason why we're able to pray. This is the reason why we're able to heal people. This is the reason why God is able to hear you. He hasn't forgotten about you. He hasn't forgotten about you. You are still loved with infinite love, and there is nothing that you could ever do that would make God reject you. This is why we believe. You gotta have faith. Not little faith, but great faith. You gotta have the desire to just give it to God. There comes a time when we stop struggling and we just give in so we can give up. What do you mean, Mike? We give in to God's will so we can give up what's tormenting us. Some of us struggle with anger. God is telling me there's anger. And God wants to relieve that right now. I don't know if you guys know Roberto, but this great man of faith contacted me this week. And he said, Pastor, I believe that God can heal me. And he says, I'm coming to the church for all the brothers. Lay hands on me. Because I believe that God can heal me in my body. He says, I suffer with all kinds of afflictions. But I'm coming, and I promised him that we would lay hands and we would pray the prayer of faith. But he also accepted God's will. He says, even if I don't get healed, I'll still keep believing. He is a testimony of the kind of faith that we should have. And if you're sitting back there thinking you don't need nothing from God, look at these people. You're not alone. We all need something from God. Especially your pastor. Nobody has the blueprint. Nobody has the accomplished success. We all are broken vessels in need of repair, struggling human spirits that struggle spiritually, emotionally, and physically.